Again, we want to say a pleasant good evening to everyone. And if you've just logged on in the chat group, we say welcome, welcome, welcome. Go ahead now and just click, copy this link, put it on Facebook, put it on YouTube, put it on WhatsApp, we're on YouTube, just share it. Now, friends, we've been saying that one of the quickest ways to learn the message is to share the message. And if you want to get a firm grasp of our doctrines, our beliefs, you need to share it. We've been going through the present truth. Is it biblical? Yes. 1 Peter 1:12, Peter says, "Wherefore I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though you know them, that you be established in the present truth." Now, present truth is basically truths for this time. Present truth basically is the Adventist message. Are you with me? And it doesn't make a fanatic out of you. I believe that people who embrace present truth and become fanatics were already inclined in fanaticism. Present truth, the title was coined by Peter. It was brought to the forefront in our denomination by James White. And one of the first, in that publication, one of the first truths, doctrines that came off that press in the early, in 1848, was the Sabbath. And so as we look at these truths, we've discussed that there is an order in giving these truths. We just don't teach them randomly or haphazardly, link after link in the prophetic chain. One doctrine lays the foundation for the other. One doctrine paves the way for the other. One doctrine strengthens the other. Now, we have covered for about over 40 lessons thus far, right? But we are technically on lesson number 25 without the subheadings. And tonight, and again, we only have 5 more lessons left, and we'd have brought this to a close. Now, tonight, we're looking at lesson number 25, New Beginning, and it's basically on the subject of baptism. Now, by this time, we would have covered enough information for your student, for them to make a decision to take their stand with Jesus, to be a part of his remnant church, and to be identified with God's commandment keeping people. Now, every lesson has an objective. And the reason why we print the objective on the teacher's lesson is to make sure that you are on track as you teach these lessons. What's the objective? To discuss the importance of baptism and to show its relation to Christ's death on the cross. Now, every lesson has a introductory paragraph which paves the way for the lesson. And we encourage that you or your other Bible worker, your other partner, right, will read this, and it now paves the way for the lesson. Now, please read. Now, let's face it.
Let's face it. We need water to live. Uh-huh. On average, a person can survive without food for weeks. However, a person can survive without water for just 3 days. Mm. Furthermore, by drinking an optimum amount of water, a person will think more clearly, have more energy, and even decrease the risk of certain cancers. Mm-hmm. Water fights for you too. A natural cleanser, it helps to dissolve harmful bacteria, fungus, radioactive substances, and the like. Water helps to bring to life and keep life going. It is, you might say, an all-in-one, and it is with good reason used as a potent symbol in the Bible. Let's take a look at how this illustration is used to represent a vital step in the Christian life, baptism.
All right, so tonight's lesson is baptism. Now, bear in mind, you are the teacher, and as you approach this lesson, it needs to be prayerful. Bear in mind, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities. And I've discovered that when this subject is presented, the devil himself, he arouses his agents, because this is a deciding lesson now. This is where appeal is being made. In the home, you would have already gone over enough lessons, and you may would have covered a few more once you've established a date, right? But again, you must be prayerful, even going into fasting, as you plan to teach this lesson to your student and to bring them out of darkness into this marvelous life. Now again, friends, these lessons are designed primarily for non-Seventh-day Adventist Christians. When I wrote these lessons, they were not written for Seventh-day Adventists. They were not. This platform is not designed to preach to Seventh-day Adventists. No. I think that these lessons are, how they are conveyed, are very, very elementary. Some will even think it's almost insulting because we do simplify them. We do simplify them because they're adapted for people who do not know, who are not familiar with our doctrines. And so I know some people say, well, this is so simple. But again, it's simple for you, yes, but it's not designed for us. It's designed for them. Now, bear in mind, in Babylon, they very seldomly use their Bibles. Their services are highly emotional charged, dark lights and, you know, music, you know, thumping. And so these truths are not known to them. And so as I approach this lesson, it is with great simplicity that I seek to convey it to you, discuss it so you can then teach it, internalize it, add to it, make it become yours, and go and teach it to others. All right? Now question number one says, now, before his ascension, what was one of the last instructions Jesus gave to his disciples? So we do have a few, you may want to do a little bit of, elaboration. Jesus spent 3.5 years with his disciples, preaching, teaching, healing. He has been crucified. He's risen. He's about to leave now. And he takes them to Bethany for the final goodbye. And as he's en route to Bethany, Matthew 28, as we find the Gospel Commission, the Bible says now, he says to them now, go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. So one of the last instructions that Jesus gave his disciples, now not everybody, because everybody can't baptize. If everybody baptized, who will be baptized? You know what I'm saying? This is just for our select few. And in the Adventist church, the only persons that are, you know, are qualified to baptize by the church or are pastors, right? Pastors commissioned, you know, by the church. And then we have elders, ordained elders. And in the absence of a pastor, based on the church manual, the elders can baptize, or the elders can baptize given the pastor's permission. So it's not anybody can perform baptism. Unfortunately, many are doing that. Just like communion, not any and everybody can handle communion. So baptism is a sacred rite. Now, I believe now, friends, you say, not, hold on now. What happens when the loud cry begins? Will it just be a select few? Listen, I can't say yeah or nay, but this I do know. If you are around, you will see. But I believe that this doctrine will be taught and many baptisms will be performed during the loud cry. But until then, only a select few. So once you have prepared your candidate for baptism, you want to notify your pastor, the head elder, that you've been working with a candidate, right? And they're at a place where they are ready to be baptized. Then they will come and ask questions and so forth. And we can all work together to get this candidate baptized into God's church. Amen? So one of the last instructions that God gave his disciples, they were to perform the ordinance of baptism. A very sacred rite. It's not something that is treated with lightness and levity. It's a very solemn and sacred rite held by the church, yea, even Christendom. Now, we want to now define what this act is, right? Question two now. Now, what is baptism? If you were to define it theologically, define it biblically, define it in your own words, what is it? Well, note, baptism is an ordinance of the New Testament instituted by Jesus Christ. Don't run past that. It wasn't instituted by anybody else but Jesus. And you say, but wasn't John the first person baptized? Yes, but who impressed John to baptize? It was the Godhead. Are you with me? So even though John was doing it, it was not by his own self. He was impressed and inspired by the Godhead, and Jesus Christ is a part of the Godhead. They all work together as one. Are you with me, right? It is intended to be, to the person baptized, a sign of his fellowship with Christ in his death and resurrection, and of his being engrafted into Christ, and of the remission of sins. It also indicates that the baptized person has given himself up to God through Jesus Christ so that he may live and conduct himself in the newness of life. Now, we're going to break that down. So that's what baptism is, just by definition. Now, once we define what baptism is, now we want to transition now by seeking to separate the true from the false, the counterfeit from the genuine, that which is scriptural and that which is unscriptural, that which is biblical and that which is unbiblical, that which is truth or that which is transition. Are you with me now? Question three now. Now, how many kinds of baptisms does the Bible sanction? Now, friends, why do we establish this question? Because there are many modes out there in the world today, but the Bible only sanctions one type of baptism. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 5, the Apostle Paul lets us know the only method of baptism that the Bible sanctions. Ephesians 4, 5, the Apostle Paul says this now, there is one body, one spirit, even as ye are called into one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one mode of baptism, one method. So the Bible only sanctions one, not two, nor three. Now, unfortunately, for every Bible truth, the devil always has a counterfeit. And the counterfeit is not too far off from the genuine. And if you don't know scripture, we are told, friends, Ellen White says that the track of truth and error lies close together, and it may seem to be one, but by some minds who are not worked by the Holy Ghost. So the Bible only sanctions one mode. You want to emphasize this, rivet this point home to your student. The Bible only sanctions one mode of baptism. Now, unfortunately, within Christendom today, there are multiplicities of what we call pseudo-baptism that is done in Christendom. And who is the author of these? They have come from the author of lies, the father of lies, the devil himself. For he is a liar from the beginning. And when he speaketh not the truth, the Bible says, right? And so as we look in Christendom, we have pouring, we have aspersion. As a matter of fact, during COVID, friends, I've even seen one man had a water gun. Literally, people were driving through COVID. I guess, you know, COVID, they didn't want to die. And people who were on their deathbed dying or so forth, they were put in the cars. And one priest, one bishop, he had a water gun. And as people was driving through, he was spraying these people. And this is what they believe to be baptism. Friends, that's an invention of the devil himself, brothers and sisters. Are you with me? Now, why then do, please read now, why do some churches
pour, some sprinkle, and some immerse? Uh-huh. Which baptism is the Bible baptism? Mm-hmm. The word baptism comes from the Greek word baptizo, meaning to dip, to immerse. Mm-hmm. The Greeks used this word to describe the immersion of cloth into dye.
All right, so friends, get this now. So when we look at the word baptism in the Greek, it means baptizo. Emphasize that it means to dip, it means to immerse. And this principle is borrowed from the textile industry. You know, I have on a black shirt. How did we get it black? It came from cotton, which is white, so they had to dip it. Use these illustrations. When I was in school, we used to make tie and dye, so we're all familiar with dyeing. So they would submerge these cloth in the dye, and it would take on different texture and different color, rather. So it means to immerse. It means to dip. Now, what about the others now? Please read now. Sprinkling.
Sprinkling. sprinkling or aspersion is the act of sprinkling a person with water instead of fully immersing them in water for baptism. Mm-hmm. Similarly, pouring or effusion is the act of pouring water on a person's head instead of fully immersing them into water during baptism.
Now, friends, it is important that you understand and are able to identify these counterfeit baptisms, because your student may be a victim of one of these. So we have sprinkling, we have pouring, we have aspersion. So be familiar with what they mean, so as you are confronted, you can explain what they mean in comparison to what the Bible teaches. Please read now. So whenever
you see the word baptize in the Bible, remember that it really means to dip or immerse. Uh-huh. Every time we see a baptism being practiced in the Bible, it is done this way. Here are a few examples.
So we're gonna highlight just a few examples in the Bible where baptizo, immersion, dipped, plunge is being used. We're gonna highlight, I could have given you a lot, but again, we wanna keep it simple. And we also want to cover this lesson in one session, if it's possible. Because we don't. When you break, you kind of break the conviction, right? So I didn't go too deep, but just simple enough for you to convey it to your student right now. So we're going to highlight three baptisms on the screen. We have one, the baptism of Jesus found in Matthew 3, 13 through 17. The baptism on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after Christ went to heaven, found in Acts 2, 38 and 41. And then other baptisms in the book of Acts, especially when Philip baptized the Ethiopian. Now, three baptisms. We want to underscore the manner in which these baptisms were done and see if they give license or liberty to practice sprinkling, aspersion, pouring, and all these other, and spray gun baptism. Right now, so let's look now at the first, Jesus baptism, which is found in Matthew chapter 3 and verses 13 through 16. Now again, you want to elaborate. Remember, Jesus Christ, give a little backdrop, was working in his stepfather's shop for 30 years. What was his profession? A mechanic? No, a tailor. No. He was a carpenter. And now, fulfilling the prophecies of the 70 weeks, yeah? Right? 69 and 2 weeks now. He is now impressed by the Spirit of God to leave his stepfather's house and to go out into full-time ministry. Now, bear in mind, John the Baptist is his cousin. Give a backdrop. Elaborate before you transition into the text, yeah? John the Baptist is his cousin. Talk about, they were first cousins. They were very, very close. Are you with me, right? In regards to Elizabeth and Mary. Now, the Bible says now in Matthew 3 now, right? The Bible says now, then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and thou comest to me. Verse 15 says now, and Jesus answering said unto them, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered him. 16 is the clincher now, right? Then Jesus, when he was baptized, went up out straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were open unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, lightning up on him. Focus on verse number 16. The Bible says Jesus came straightway up out of the water, and from deductive reason, it meant that he was fully immersed. He was fully submerged by John the Baptist. And it tells me you can't baptize yourself. No. You see, in order for it to be valid, it should be done by a person who is sanctioned by the church. Are you with me, right? So here we see Christ's method of baptism was not sprinkling, was not pouring, was not water gun. It was immerse, it was to dip. No. So you may say, now, why did Jesus have to get baptized if he is perfect? That's a very good question. Remember, no, Jesus Christ did no sin, yet he identified himself with sinners, taking the steps that we are to take as soon as we follow him. To fulfill all righteousness is to give an example of right doing and underscore the fact, emphasize the fact, that Jesus Christ is not just our example in some things, he is our example in all things. And if Jesus was baptized by immersion, then if I want to follow Jesus, be like Jesus all day long in the home and in the throng, I would want to follow the method that Jesus was a recipient of, which was by dipping, which was by plunging. Friends, you want to highlight the fact that Jesus Christ is our example, right? So once we see that in Jesus used the method of submersion, right? Let's transition now. 50 days after Christ is in heaven now. The apostles now are actually fulfilling Matthew 28 verse 18. Go ye therefore. Now in the book of Acts, backdrop now, Pentecost, Holy Ghost has fallen, Peter is preaching, the crowd is convicted, right? Now, even though Acts 2 does not say that they were dipped, but from deductive reasoning, if the apostles are going to follow what Jesus, to carry out Jesus' command, they can't add or take away. And since Jesus' baptism was the ideal, was the blueprint, then every other baptism after that by the apostles should have that stamp. Are you with me? And the reason why, because you're not going to see the word dip or submerge or up out of the water, but they were baptized. Now, Acts 2, the Bible says now, Acts 2 says now, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, baptizo, to be dipped, to be submerged, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and he shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Then they gladly received his word and were baptized, and in the same day they were added unto them 3,000 souls, 3,000 persons were baptized on the day of Pentecost. But how were they baptized? The Greek word is to dip. They were baptized in the same manner that Jesus was baptized. And when Jesus told his disciples to go ye therefore and baptize and teach, he didn't say go ye therefore and sprinkle. Go ye therefore and pour. Or buy a water gun and just, you know, in case of infectious diseases, just kind of, no. That's not the biblical mode. You see, so Christ's method of baptism was by immersion, and then we have the apostles. Now, by this time, your student may want to interject. So again, you give them space and place to ask questions, to elaborate, and so forth. Right now, one more example of the biblical mode of baptism now. And again, every time you see baptism done in the Bible, it's by this mode. We have left Jerusalem now. Persecution has broken out by the Apostle Paul in Jerusalem. And Philip, he goes down to Samaria. He does a great job down there. The Spirit now takes Philip and he sends him to Gaza. There is a black man, an Ethiopian man. He's coming from Africa. He goes to Jerusalem and he buys a Spirit of Prophecy book, the book of Isaiah, from the ABC store. He's going back home and he doesn't really understand. And the Holy Ghost I'm giving you backdrop now, right? The leading. The Holy Ghost now takes Philip from Samaria and drops him, bam, beam me up, Scotty, on the road to Gaza. Now, the text says now, right? And so Philip is now teaching the Ethiopian. And the Bible says now, Acts 8 now, and when they went on their way, they came to a certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hindereth me to be baptized? Meaning, what was hindering him from getting baptized or not? What was hindering the Ethiopian from getting baptized? Someone baptized him. Well, Philip was there. There was no water. He's saying, okay. And I believe that Philip was discussing baptism. So, okay, I like it, but where's the water? And all of a sudden, they came to a point. He said, hold on. Okay, if we need water, here's water. What hindereth me? Here's water. 37 says, now, and Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, that thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. 38 says now, right? And he commanded his chariot to stand still. And they both, what? Went down into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And he came up, and the Spirit took him. So here we see now, and they parted their ways. All right? And listen, this was the first Gentile to be converted to Christianity. Right? It was a black man, Ethiopian. Are you with me, right? So here we see now that this man is baptized, but how was he baptized? He was baptized by immersion. Three examples. And again, all we need in Scripture to sustain any truth is just three texts, two or three witnesses. Paul says, in the mouth of two or three witnesses or two or three examples, let every word be established, right? So we have sufficient information to deduce that baptism in the Bible, and from henceforth, it was only done by immersion until later on time. Now, so here we are, three examples, Christ's baptism, Pentecost baptism, and other, and I've only given you Philip, but there are other texts you can use in the study guide to, and you can see that baptism was done through this mode only. Right now, so how did these other modes come into the church? Now, I'm going to read to you from a book by Cardinal Gibbons, The Faith of Our Fathers. And Cardinal Gibbons, prior to his death, he was the highest Roman Catholic voice in America. As a matter of fact, I live in Fort Lauderdale, and they have many schools in Fort Lauderdale named after him, Cardinal Gibbons. We played against him when we played soccer, right? So he was a person of renown, worth in the Catholic Church prior to his death at the time, right? Now look what he says now in the book on The Faith of Our Fathers, page 227, please, about baptism and how these counterfeit baptisms arose. Please read now.
For several centuries after the establishment of Christianity, baptism was conferred by immersion. Mm-hmm. But since the 12th century, the practice of baptizing by infusion has prevailed in the Catholic Church. Mm. As this manner is attended with less inconvenience than baptism by immersion.
Wow, mercy. In other words, they were inconvenienced. And you know, I see something today, and probably I shouldn't say it, but I don't like it. I don't like it, you know. Especially within our church, you see people getting baptized, and you see pastor, they have these suits. I've seen in our church where people, the pastor stays outside the pool, and the candidate is in the pool, and he reaches in and baptizes them, or they put on these suits because they don't want to get wet. Friends, every time it is done, the one conducting the baptism and the candidate both make their way in the water, and they both go down together, right? The one doing it partially, but the one receiving it fully. You see, they didn't want to get wet, their long robes and your girdles to get wet. So it was too inconvenient, brothers. And I'm telling you something, every counterfeit truth that the devil has brought about, inconvenience has always been there. You look at the worship service in our churches. Why don't we sing the hymns anymore? Oh, they're too old, and people don't know them. Well, teach them the hymns then. Let me tell you something, friends. I've gone to the bedside of the dead and the dying. And you know what I always hear playing? It's hymns. When I go to the bedside of the sick and dead and dying, they don't want no boogie aga in their ears. They want something calm. They want the hymns. Inconvenience. And so it is. Every erosion of principle within our churches has its root in inconvenience. Inconvenience, an inconvenient truth. It is so sad, my brothers and sisters, right? But this is how it came in the church right now. So we've established now the examples of baptism. Number four now, right? Now, what does baptism by immersion symbolize? Why do we do it? I mean, why? Huh?
You're not checked. There's a question in the chat.
Okay, question.
Jesus saves.
Question. Is there a Bible text that restricts who can perform baptism? All right. Okay. Good questions, you say. Now, I'm just giving you, you know, we're discussing. In Matthew chapter 1, Jesus ordained 12. He did ordain 12, right? The apostles. In Matthew 28, when he gave the commission, while there were others there, but he was speaking primarily to the church. And out of that biblical principle now, we see in the baptism, we see in the Bible now, right? The deacons in the early church were established by the apostles. Persecution broke out. Philip was a deacon in Jerusalem, right? And he goes to Samaria, he preaches, he baptizes. He leaves Samaria and he goes to Gaza and he is baptized. So based on that, Jesus says, I would say that persons who are qualified to be baptized, who are qualified to do baptism, should be given authority by the church. Deacons can baptize because Philip was a deacon. Elders can baptize, right? And so an elder is masculine, not feminine. Are you with me? Right? So here we see now that God has a church and not any and everyone can do baptism. Now, hear me now. During the Olympics, when the athletes are in the block, it's the most intense part of the race because if they jump the gun, what happens to them? They get disqualified. Yeah. Now, we don't want to jump the gun because if we do that and start allowing any and everybody to baptize, we'll be disqualified. I believe that when the Sunday law is passed and God's people are scattered and the latter is poured out, I believe now that God will be working through a different dispensation. You see what I'm saying? He will, because we won't have the structure. There won't be no right hand of fellowship. No, we're running. But until then, Jesus says, we don't want to jump the gun. Until then, persons who are qualified to lead on baptism are persons that are given authority by the church, meaning pastors, meaning elders, meaning deacons. It's not a trivial rite that any person can do. And so we got to be careful. We got to be very, 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 very careful, right? We got to be very, very careful, right? All right. Thank you very much. All right. And keep those questions coming. Now, what does baptism by immersion, what does it symbolize? Why do we go under? In 1 Corinthians, in Romans chapter 6, 3 and 4, the Apostle Paul gives us the meaning and the symbolism. And you, friends, you want to take your time here because it means a lot now. Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4, Paul says now, know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death, underscore death. Therefore, we are buried, underscore buried, with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was raised, underscore raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in the newness of life. Verse 5 says now, for if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also in the likeness of his resurrection. So what the Apostle Paul is here using, he is using a common entity in the early Christian church, this entity of death. Everybody can relate to death. Everybody knows somebody who has died. And so the reason why Paul is using this death concept, because as Paul was looking around, many of his fellow Christian compadres were dying. So he's using death, burial, as a springboard to introduce what baptism is. So the Apostle Paul highlights three things in the text. He highlights death, he highlights burial, and he highlights resurrection, right? In the same vein of baptism. So now, the first thing we're going to fill in now is death. Death. When a person steps into the water and holds his breath, it symbolizes death. You're dead. You can't breathe. When I do baptism, and you know, there's a way that they have to hold your wrist, and you have that white cloth, and I say to them now, I'm going to pinch your nose, just hold your breath. You know why? If you're breathing, water can get into your nostrils and you can really die. Right? We don't want that, right? Die, right? Okay, that's a double negative, right? But the point is now, it symbolizes that you are dead. Dead to who? Dead to the world. Dead to the flesh. You are dead. Friends, you only baptize dead people. You only bury dead people. And that is why whenever somebody dies, you cannot pronounce a person dead. It has to be somebody that is sort of, I'd say, either the police officer or the coroner. Because if you were to ever cremate a person who is not dead, that would be a tragedy and a lawsuit. Or to bury a person that is not dead. Did you know that in World War, in the Civil War, I have the article, that there was a man that fell in a coma, and they didn't know what a coma was. They thought he was dead. And friends, as they were taking that man to the grave and putting the dirt on him, they start hearing boom, 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 boom. Everybody took off. That man was not dead. That's why you have to be legally pronounced dead by either the police officer or the doctor. They check your pulse and so forth. You are dead. Because if you bury a dead person, an undead person, it's a tragedy. And so the only persons who are baptized or should be baptized by immersion are people who are dead. So once you're dead, what do you do now? Do they stay home? No? Notice Paul didn't say cremate, right? Paul says bury. Look what happened now. Burial is mentioned in the text now. Burial. When he is lowered beneath the water, it symbolizes a burial. Before a burial, we must have death. Before we are buried into baptism, we die to our old life of sin by turning away from our own sinful habits. You see the wonderful illustration that the Apostle Paul uses in the concept of death. And they were like, oh, I understand it now, right? So teach this to your student. Third thing now, right? Once a person is dead, Paul speaks of a future resurrection, right? Resurrection now. Here it is now. Coming up out of the water symbolizes the resurrection. When a beautiful memorial of our Lord's death and burial and resurrection, the old life of sin is buried and it is now dead and new life in Christ begin. Friends, sprinkling, pouring cannot symbolize this miniature death, burial and resurrection experience. Only immersion conveys this beautiful concept. So when we teach, or not we, when they teach or practice sprinkling and aspersion, they are distorting, or they have distorted the beautiful analogy, illustration that the Apostle Paul gave to the Christian church as to what it means. You cannot convey the meaning of baptism by sprinkling or pouring or hosing down or using a water gun. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you a true story. We were conducting a baptism at Wellington a couple months ago. And, you know, it was a beautiful day. And I saw some ladies who I wasn't familiar with, and they came to the baptism. Now, I'm thinking that they were supportive persons of the person getting baptized. And so they came, they sat, we sang, we blessed the water, I went in the pool and so forth and so forth. And we did the baptism. When I was finished, I got changed, and one of the ladies said, Pastor, and this is in 2022, or 21, 22, 22, 21, 21, 22. She said to me, I kid you not, this was the first time I've ever seen a baptism being performed like this. Friends, my mouth almost dropped open. I'm like, in my mind, sister girl, where have you been? No, she's been around. She says, I was wondering what this water, I thought we were coming to a pool party. She said, why do we need so much water? Because in her context, baptism is not done by this. So it was an eye-opener for her to see baptism being performed, right? Being performed the biblical way. So don't take it for granted. Because we're in the church and we see it so often, we think everybody in Christendom or in the world knows this. No, they do not. If they did, we would have to teach it. You see, friends, right? So bear these things in mind, right? So we see what baptism means. It means a death. It means a burial. And it also means a resurrection. Now, the Bible has certain requirements for baptisms. What are they? And you need to know this. Number one, the first requirement for baptism is this now. There must be biblical instructions in righteousness or right doing. There must be instructions. Where do you find that? Go back to Matthew 28. When Jesus told his disciples to go and baptize, he didn't say go and sing and baptize. Or have a mini concert, then when their emotions are stirred, you baptize them. Look what he said. He says in Matthew 28, go ye therefore, teach all nations, baptizing them, and then you teach some more. So teaching commences the work, and teaching concludes the work, and baptism is like you're making a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, right? One slice of bread is teaching, the jelly and the jam are mixed together, right? Is the baptism, you smudge it on the bread, but that's not a good sandwich. You need another slice of bread to go wham and put it together. You see, so there must be instructions given to the person, adequate, clear instruction. That's why we don't push baptism at the front of the lesson. And I am leery, I am incredulous when I go to crusades and I see the opening night, the evangelist is called for baptism. And you know what they say? This is their rationale. Oh, these are people who they have been working with. That's a lie. They who? You show me where Bible workers are going out to do any kind of field work. That's not true. It's because they are numbers driven. It's a hype thing. There must be adequate information. Acts chapter 8, verse 12, whenever baptism is done, instructions in righteousness has always preceded it. It's not baptized, pardon me, then teach. Acts 8, 12, the Bible says now, but when they believed, Philip preaching the things concerning the kingdom and in the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. This is Philip in Samaria. Are you with me? But look what happened. Philip preached, he taught things pertaineth to the kingdom of God. Then they were baptized. It wasn't baptized, or we don't want to offend them, so we're going to withhold the truth, get their emotions stirred, baptize them, and then we're gonna have a baptismal class or a Bible class. Friends, look around. Most of our churches don't even have Bible class, and the only church that does it are the West Indian churches. African American churches, Bible class is dead. Not to mention the Caucasian churches. We don't even have that anymore. So don't come talk about, yeah, we're going to baptize them, you know, or they use this cynical illustration. Oh, I only catch fish. I don't clean them up. The pastor cleans them up. Clean up who? He can't clean up himself. There must be instructions first. Note, brothers and sisters, every candidate. Please read now, every candidate.
Every candidate for baptism should understand fully what it means to become a follower of Christ. It is not enough to say, I believe in Christ. For today, that may mean almost anything.
Because the devil believes. Please read.
Before one can truly know whether or not he believes in Jesus, he must also know what Jesus believed and taught.
All right. Very important. So there must be instructions. Must be instructed. Now, let me see this, friends. I'm no Pharisee, yeah? Far from it. Neither am I Sadducee. Every rule has an exception. It does. Now, there are situations that may arise where a candidate will not be able to go through 25 lessons or 30 lessons. Things happen. So what do you do? There are certain lessons that must be covered before they go in the baptism water. These are the basics, friends. It is a case where you don't have 28 lessons to go through. You can select these lessons out of the study guides and cover them. And then you arrange for you to go back and fill in the blanks. Here they are, jot them down. I should have put them in the lesson. Number one, the Bible must be covered. That this is the only rule of faith and practice for the Christian. You must let them know about the Bible. Number two, you must cover the lesson on salvation. How are people saved? Why are we saved? Through whose name are we saved? What does it mean to be saved? You also must cover the second coming. Why are we being saved? Why do we need the Bible? Because Jesus Christ is coming soon. The third truth that must be covered, the fourth, is the Sabbath. We must cover the Lord's day. and how to keep it. Right? You cannot baptize a person within the Seventh-day Adventist Church and not cover the Sabbath. That is wickedness. And many are guilty because, again, if you cover the Sabbath, you're going to run them. So just praise and get your emotions stirred and preach these self-help sermons, and we'll baptize them and let the pastor teach them. It never happens. You must cover the Sabbath. Number four, you must cover health. Now, I'm not talking about vegetarianism and veganism now. Okay, I'm making cashew butter. And nothing wrong with cashew butter. I'm making almond milk. No, we're talking about health in the context of my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And God expects me to care for it by abstaining and refraining from things and substance that are harmful. Certain kind of things that we cannot eat and things we can eat. You have to cover that. And we are told we should not baptize people who are willingly using narcotics. Tobacco in all its form. Exactly. You have to cover this. Now, I'm going to tell you a true story. I was up in upstate New York doing the Soul Winner training a few months ago. And I was at the house of a godly family. And their sister came to stay at the house. Now, every night we went to church doing the Soul Winner, and the sister would come to the church with me. Now, I never knew she was an Adventist because she looked like she wasn't an Adventist. Then she said to me, Pastor Knott, I would love for you to come to my church in Texas and do this study. She said, but my church is very, very liberal. Now, so we covered this, and she said, you know, I want to tell you a true story. She says, the other day, a man came into the church to get baptized. He just came to church, and the pastor made an appeal for baptism, and the man walked down the aisle. Nobody ever saw him, and the pastor, we're going to baptize him right now. So they sang, and they filled the pool up, and the man was baptized. And you may say, praise the Lord, hallelujah, to God be the glory, are you Pharisees, the man is joining the church. But guess what now? As the man started to come to church, they always had potluck. This is a true story she's telling me now. She says, now, the man, there was a particular dish that was on the line. She works in the kitchen, and she says, now, as everybody was eating the dish, she went and she took a serving, and she noticed that in the serving, it was black beans and what a casserole, but it had bacon in it. So I said to her, maybe it is veg bacon. She said, Pastor, I know veg bacon. I know Linkets. It doesn't have that strong. And she took a piece of it, and it was actually bacon that somebody had brought to the potluck. And so she went to the kitchen and told the ladies, and they said, well, it's too late now. Everybody's eating it. We don't want to cause a stir. So they were watching to see who actually brought the dish. You know who put the dish home? The same guy that was baptized. You can't fuss him. He didn't know that we don't eat pork. You see why it's important, saints, for us? A true story. I was flabbergasted. And we sat together eating lunch. And she said, Pastor, I see why you emphasize teaching these things, at least these basics, before they get baptized. I'm not talking about now vegetarianism now. I'm not going to that. They can grow into that. But the basics. So you must cover health. And you also must cover the state of the dead. And to let them know that certain artifacts, voodoo, obia, the man down there, you have to abstain from these things. We must cover the gift of prophecy. You have to cover it. And you must cover baptism. Why baptism? Because here's a man. He shows up one Sabbath at your church. The pastor makes an appeal. And his emotion is stirred. He wants to get baptized. The pool is being prepared. As he's being changed now, he comes. And he says, why all this water? I'm not going in there. I don't want to drown. At my church, they sprinkle. Can't you all sprinkle? Can't you all pour? That's a commotion in the church. People are looking, what in the world is going on? That's why you must teach them. And the last one you must cover, you must cover Christian standards, lifestyle. As a Christian, you cannot go certain places. You're dead to certain relationships, to certain music, certain movies, certain attractions. Friends, you must, and it is a crime against heaven for any man to perform baptism in the Adventist church and don't have the decency to at least cover these nine doctrines. Now, again, this is a special case, and there are exceptions to the rule. But if that's the case, you have to extract these lessons and cover them with the hope that you will go back and fill in the other gaps. You see? So please get that in mind. So again, Tyre has a question. Who? Tyre Brown. Okay. What about people with special needs are not able to do studies? Are they able to get... Okay, special needs. Oh, you know what? People with special needs, maybe autistic people. I worked in the autistic field for many years. And my wife is a special ed teacher. And when I see the pictures of them, you know, I laugh because kids with special needs, we have to use pictures to convey concepts. So you have to find a way to illustrate it. Maybe it's visually, flashcards, pictures, 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, but Brian, there has to be some kind of instruction. And again, every case may differ. You have to adapt the truth to that case, but you cannot just disannul the truth and just baptize him, right? Heaven would not be happy with that, right? So there must be instruction in righteousness, right? Number two, there must be a genuine repentance, right? Genuine repentance, right? Whenever baptism is about to be performed, repentance always precedes it. Acts 2:38, the Bible says now, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized. In verse 41, and they were baptized. There must be repentance. What is repentance? It's godly sorrow. Sorrow, you're sorry, not that you get caught. Sorry for the sin itself. And that's why the Apostle Paul, in 2 Corinthians 7:10, he speaks of two kinds of sorrow. He speaks of a godly sorrow and a worldly sorrow. 2 Corinthians 7:10, Paul says now, for godly sorrow, which worketh repentance to salvation, not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death. There's two types of repentance. Go back in our archives and look at the series called Repentance. Powerful series we did, right? 10 lessons. True repentance means you're sorry for the sin, you care less about the consequence. Worldly repentance, you're sorry for the consequence and not the sin. There must be true repentance, and that is brought on not by music or by puppets or by drama. It's brought on by the Holy Ghost. Right? So there must be repentance. Now, number three, there must be a genuine conversion. Conversion. When I'm going to Jamaica, I have to convert the American dollar to Jamaican dollar so I get somewhere, I get a whole heap of money, which we don't mean it's light. It's just enough, but it's light. It's like money light in Jamaica, but you have to convert it. So conversion means you is a change, right? Whenever you see baptism in the Bible and repentance, conversion is not too far off. Acts 3:19, Peter says now, repent ye therefore and be converted. Converted. No, now please read now. Genuine conversion.
Genuine conversion leads to genuine change.
There it is.
Have you put away any practices that displease Jehovah, such as living immorally, using tobacco, or using foul or abusive language, etc.?
Etc. A conversion, a change. It must be a change. And let me say this. The change will be demonstrated before baptism. It must be. Right? Last one now. There must be a genuine belief. There must be a genuine, a sincere belief in God's revealed truth. Mark 16:16, the Bible says, he that believeth and is baptized, the same shall be saved. There must be a genuine belief. Note, please read now. If they believe...
If they believe the gospel and give themselves to be Christ's disciples, if they renounce the devil, the world, and the flesh, and are devoted to Christ as their prophet, priest, and king, they shall be saved from the guilt and power of sin.
There must be a belief. Right. Now, these 4 points have been demonstrated in probably one of the greatest religious revivals in the history of this world. It is captured in a book called The Great Controversy, a great religious revival, where God used Puritan preachers to proclaim the truth. Now look at the effect and look at the result. The Bible says, now when these souls heard the truth, please read now,
These souls brought forth fruit, meat for repentance.
They what?
They believed and were baptized and rose to walk in newness of life.
There it is.
New creatures in Jesus Christ, not to fashion themselves according to the former lusts, but by the faith of the Son of God to follow in his steps, to reflect his character, and to purify themselves even as he is pure.
Look at the conversion now. The things they once hated, they now loved. The things they once loved, they now hated. The proud and self-assertive became meek and lowly in heart. The vain and supercilious became serious and unobtrusive. The profane became reverent. The drunkard became sober. The profligate became pure. The vain fashion of the world, were laid aside. Christians saw not the outward adorning of the plating of hair and the wearing of gold, brothers and sisters. In other words, they took the jewelry off. They weren't baptized in jewelry. And so many are doing it because they do not teach Christian standards. When we cover Christian standards in our next lesson, we cover all of that. And we do it tactfully and tastefully and in love. I have seen so many baptisms, brothers and sisters, within the Adventist Church being done. People go down with big old hoops. As a matter of fact, half the people who are singing on the stage have hoops on. They need to be born again. It's the norm now. Somebody said the issue of jewelry in the church is lost. I'm going to preach against it anyway. And the Bible is clear about it. And we're going to cover that. Yeah? We're not going to baptize nobody no jewelry. No. We're going to teach them. And then the Holy Ghost cut. Listen, friends. I used to have one stud here, one stud here, one stud here. And I had 4 holes in my ear. And when the Spirit of God convicted me that night, I took those things off. And I was baptized. No, I still struggle, don't get me wrong, but by and by, at least I knew that they were unacceptable. And by, I gained the victory in Christ Jesus. Now, today, jewelry don't move me. It don't move me. My ears are clogged up. Are you with me? So this is what it is like when a person is ready for baptism, right? As we wind down now. Is there any, number 6 now, is there anything magical or mystical used in the water, about the water? Is the water magical? No, brothers and sisters. There's nothing magical about the water. No. As a matter of fact, please read now. There
were no healing substances in the water of that river. There is no magic in the water that we use. It is the same kind of water that we drink and the same kind that we bathe in. By baptism, our sins are washed away, but the water itself is not what cleanses us.
What cleanses it is what?
It is the faith in the blood of Jesus Christ. Baptism does not mean we are now perfect. Nor does it mean we will never again sin or that Satan will no longer tempt us. Jesus was strongly tempted right after his baptism, but he overcame the temptation through prayer and quoting scriptures.
There's nothing special about the water. I've known people pay thousands of dollars to go down to the River Jordan to get baptized in that dirty water. Hey, if you got the money, that's on you. But your baptism in the River Jordan is of no greater significance or better than mine. It's just regular water that we pray over and ask God to bless the symbolism, right? Number 7 now. Can a person be saved in God's kingdom without being baptized? Right? They may say, well, preacher, I don't need to get baptized. Huh? Now, there are two examples that we turn to. Two cases. One, the thief on the cross. The other is a jailer. Look what happened now. The thief on the cross. The Bible says now in Luke 23:39 now, and one of the malefactors were hanged, railed on him, saying, if thou be the Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, dost thou not fear God, seeing that thou art in the same condemnation? 41 says now, we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward for our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto him, Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest in thy kingdom. And look what Jesus said. Hold on, thief. Me can't help you, you know. Because the eye never get baptized. The eye on his own. No, look what he said now. Jesus said, verily, verily, I say unto you, this day thou shalt be with me in paradise. And we covered that already in the thief on the cross. Jesus Christ assured this man of salvation even though he could not get baptized. Well, preacher, there it is. Saying, I don't have to get baptized because the thief on the cross didn't get baptized. And the reason why the thief on the cross didn't get baptized, he was nailed to a cross. He couldn't get down. But let me give you one more example now. Here is a jailer. Paul and Silas are in prison now. There's a great earthquake. The doors are thrown open. The jailer thinks that they've been beaten, that they're going to escape. And if they escape, it was his neck. In the book of Acts 16, the Bible says now, and when the keeper of the prison awakened out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm. Do not commit suicide. Lord, have mercy. That's a biblical injunction against suicide. Do thyself no harm. You see it, right? And he was so, and he was so raptured by that. 32 says now, and they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in the house. 33 says now, and he took them the same hour, the night, and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all he that are his straightway. So here we see now, thief on the cross didn't get baptized because he never had the opportunity. He's on the cross. So Christ's baptism covered him. But here is a jailer who had the opportunity to get baptized, and he did. So, please read now. While the story?
While the story of the thief on the cross shows that one can be saved without baptism, the story of the Philippian jailer shows that if we have the opportunity, we should be baptized.
Uh-huh.
Both stories show that we should not delay any opportunity to make things right with God.
Here it is. So for those who don't have the opportunity, sincerely, God, Christ, baptism, his righteousness covers them. Those who can do it and refuse to do it, then you put yourself in another category and you don't want to, right? All right. Number 8 now. Is it true that a person has to be at least 12 years old to get baptized? That's not true. You know, the reason why this age thing, 12, comes in is because Jesus was 12 when he went to the temple, right? The Bible does not give an age. Proverbs 2:11 says, even a child is known by his own doing. You have a lot of children, young children, that even though they are young in age, their mind is mature. Like Izzy. I've spoken to many little children. And as I went to Izzy's house and we studied and so forth, I was amazed at her level of comprehension. Very brilliant young lady. And I know God has a special work for her to do. So many children are young in age, but old mentally. Many people are old in age and young mentally. Then, so it's not an age, but we do not do infant baptism. Right. No, please read on.
Baptism requires being taught, being able to believe, being repentant, and accepting Jesus as a personal savior from sin. Since infants and babies cannot do any of these, they cannot be baptized. Baptism is only for those old enough to understand truth, repent of their sins, and accept Jesus as savior.
But has God given us a ceremony for the infants and babies? Yes. In Mark 10:13, we see Jesus blessing little children and infant and babies, dedicating them. So there's a service for children, dedication, baby blessing. But we don't baptize infants because infants cannot comprehend, right? Number nine now. People are usually apt to buy a product based on the benefits. So as you're teaching this now, we want to highlight now what are some of the biblical benefits one receive after baptism. Here are a few, just a few. Number one, the Holy Spirit is given. Before baptism, he is over us. After, he lives in us. The Bible says in Mark 1 verse 10 now that, and straightway come out of water, he saw the heavens open, Jesus, and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. Whenever true baptism is done, the Holy Spirit is there to bless and to take up residence in the person getting baptized. Acts 5:32 says now that the Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them who disobey. No, to them who obey. People who are obedient to baptism are assured that they will have the Holy Spirit, and he will be our constant guide through life's journey as long as we don't grieve him. Number two, power is given to us. We need power to live in this world, brothers and sisters. The Bible says in John 1:12, but as many as received him, pardon me, to them he gave power to become sons of God. Power, that word power means dunamis, it means dynamite. Power to live a godly and a consistent life. Power to say no to wrong. Power to say yes to right. Number three, we are granted membership in God's remnant church. We are adopted now into a local church body and also into the heavenly body. After baptism, we no longer are isolated individuals. We become member of Christ's church. And let me say this, friends, it is a blessing and a privilege and an honor to be a member of the Seventh-day Adventist church. And we don't take it for granted. You become members. Look what happened when the early church members joined the local church. Acts says now, and they sold their possessions and their goods and parted them to all men and every man at his need. And they began to break bread and they did eat their meat. There was a camaraderie, a fellowship, a family. Your needs become my needs. When you hurt, I hurt. When any way I can help, I'm going to help. Because we are brothers, and that's what family do. Family stick together in hard times. Are you with me? So there are benefits that one can derive only if they get baptized, right? And the last one now, we are assigned our own personal guardian angel. There is a myth going around there. We may teach on it one night, not one of these nights, that everybody has a guardian angel. That's not true. That's not scriptural. Guardian angels are only assigned to people who have accepted Jesus Christ as their personal savior. Notice I didn't say denomination. Through baptism. Where do you find that? Psalms 30. You find it in Matthew 18 verse 10, where Jesus says that these little ones, their angels have access to me. Little ones meaning not little children, but newly born babe in the faith, newly baptized candidates. Psalms 34:7, David says, the angel of the Lord encampeth around them that feareth him and are delivered from him. So we have our own guardian angel. We're told in Great Controversy, a powerful book. So please read now. A guardian angel?
A guardian angel is appointed to every follower of Christ. These heavenly watchers shield the righteous from the power of the wicked one. The angels appointed to minister to the children of God have at all times access to his presence.
Here it is, our own guardian angel. Right now, as we wind down, what about the question of rebaptism? Is it biblical? Is rebaptism biblical? Yes. Acts 19 as we close. And it came to pass, while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus and finding certain disciples. Disciples meaning they were baptized, right? Two says now, and he saith unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? And they said unto him, we have not so much heard whether there was a Holy Ghost. We never heard these teaching. We never heard about the Sabbath, state of the dead, second coming, mark of the beast. We never heard these things. And he said unto them, unto what were ye baptized? He said, unto John's baptism. So John didn't teach us. He said, no. Verse 4 says now, So then said Paul, John truly baptized you with baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is the Christ. When they heard these things, they were what? Baptized. No, they were re-baptized. They were re-baptized. So, friends, there is a biblical ground for re-baptism. When new truths have been brought to the forefront, right? No, please read now. Although baptism,
Is generally performed only once, a person should be rebaptized upon repentance if he has broken his covenant with God through apostasy. There is also an example of rebaptism for other reasons than apostasy.
All right. When Paul?
When Paul found some disciples in Ephesus, they already believed the truth and were already baptized with a correct baptism and in the right manner. But when they received a clearer knowledge of the truth, they were rebaptized. Acts 19, 1 through 5. Honest souls, when come to the knowledge of present truth, will recognize the need to go through the door to enter Christ's spiritual kingdom.
So, Sister Eve, then you ask a powerful question. Is profession of faith biblical? Now, I don't really subscribe to it. Because what faith are you professing in? You were in Babylon. You were in confusion, darkness, all kind of doctrine of devils. When new truths come, it is your privilege to get re-baptized. Now, it is true, most of these people who... Now, again, context is even now. Profession of faith is usually given to people who were already baptized by immersion. Now, while the church can force... So here's a sister. She's a Baptist who were baptized. She was baptized by immersion. She don't feel that she needs to get re-baptized, right? It's her personal choice. You can't force her, but we can encourage her and we can pray over it. Now, in all my years of doing evangelism and preaching for over 20 odd years now, all my campaigns, I have never had no profession of faith. Everybody who came in, they were convinced and convicted that they need to wheel and come again, for lack of a word, to be washed. But again, the candidate can be urged, but you can't force the candidate. So if they don't want to do it, then it's another conversation. But I don't really subscribe. I know it's done in our churches, but I don't really subscribe to it. I like to follow the biblical mode, right? All right. Now, and so now, once you've covered this now, you want to seal the deal that baptism is an urgent matter for every believer. Baptism is not a command, is a command of Christ and ought to be forthwith and complied with as soon as man believe. It is an urgent thing. Annas went to Paul and he says in Acts 22:16, now why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized, wash away your sins, calling on Jesus Christ. The Ethiopian, when he says, hey, seest here water, what hindereth me? Now by this time, you've been with your candidate now for many lessons. So they would have covered, you'd have covered enough for them to be prepared for baptism. So as you now begin to appeal to them now, you would ask them, Tom, we have some questions on the back of the lesson. Which one of these you think best fits your case? Just tick that one. Now, bear in mind, you're praying now. Your voice has changed. You're now using your appeal voice. You're wooing them in. After over 25 studies, Paul, which one appeals to you? Tick. Is it A? I believe that the following Jesus' example in baptism is important. And they'll tick that one. I believe it is clear from the scripture that New Testament baptism is total immersion. Three, I believe that faith and repentance should precede baptism and that these will result in a difference in my life. Last one now. Just as with Jesus, baptism for me must be both water and the Holy Ghost. And lastly now, I have not been baptized by immersion yet, and I choose to follow my Lord and be baptized soon. Friends, if they have hung with you for over 25 lessons, you've met their needs, you've won their confidence, you follow Christ's method, they will willingly, eagerly tick, if not all. At this time now, you're excited, you embrace them, you pray with them. You will then now let them know, I'm going to speak to my pastor, my elders, and arrange a date which fits your calendar. So we're going to bring some dates. So bring some suggested dates for them. Don't say next week, because they may want to invite their friends and their family. So it's a special day for them. So you're trying to accommodate their needs. So you bring several dates, the 15th, 21st, which one best suits you. And once they check that one, next lesson now, then you let the church know. And you make it a special day for them. You get them a nice gift bag. You get them, make it special. Use your creativity and make that day special for them as they go all the way in the water of grace. Friends, as it was with us, so by the grace of God, we believe it will be with them. And then you close off with prayer. Let us pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we are so thankful for this solemn rite, this solemn study that the devil has confused in Christendom. And it is incumbent upon us to go and teach it to others and to give them the invitation to get baptized. May the Holy Ghost attend our teaching, our preaching, our living, so that conviction will come. We pray for everyone online tonight. May you bless them in their going out and their coming in. May you use us, O God, to make disciples. And like the early church, may we add to your remnant church daily those that should be saved. Give us all a good night's rest, we pray, reassuring and reaffirming dreams to reaffirm our faith. Give us the strength we need to take on this week's challenges and bring us here back at the appointed time. It's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.